morning to all of you. Now we are going to talk about the remaining concept of the chapter first order logic. Now the point is the electronic circuit domains. Means suppose you want to make the artificial intelligence in case of electronic circuits, then how we are going to apply it into electronic circuits? So first we have to identify the task. So there are many reasoning tasks associated with digital circuits. At the highest level, one analyzes the circuit functionality. So first we have to analyze the functionality of the circuit. For example, does the circuit in figure 8.6 actually add properly? So first we have to analyze the circuit whether it has added properly or not. If all inputs are high, what is the output of a gate A2? The questions about the circuit structure are also interesting. For example, what are all the gates connected to the first input terminal? Does the circuit contains feedback loops? There will be our task in this section. There are more detailed levels of analysis including those related to timing, delays, circuit areas, power consumption, production cost and so on. Each of these levels would acquire additional knowledge. Now the next is assemble the relevant knowledge. First we have to analyze the circuit and after that we have to assemble whatever the knowledge we have. So what do we know about a digital circuit for our purpose? They are composed of wires and gates, signal flow along wires to the input terminals of the gates, and each gate produces a signal on the output terminal that flows along another wire. To determine what these signals will be, we need to know how the gates transform their input signals. There are four types of the gates, AND, OR and XOR have two inputs terminal and not have only one. So we have to analyze what are the inputs and what are the terminals and what the signals represents. So after this analyzing, all the gates have one output terminal. Circuits like gates have input and output terminals. To reason about functionality and the connectivity, we do not need to talk about the wire themselves, the path they take or junction where they come together. All that matter is the connection between terminals. We can say that one output terminal is connected to another input terminal without having to say what actually connects them. Other factors such as size, shape, color or cost of the various components are irrelevant to our analysis. Now this is one sample circuit. Here we have to analyze what kind of circuits or what kind of adders we have used, what the gates we have used. For example, whether we have used AND gate, OR gate, XOR gate or NOT gate, and what is the functionality of the gates. So this basic understanding and the assembly of the basic, you should know about it. So this is the diagram, a digital circuit C1 purposing to be an 1-bit full adder. The first two inputs are 2 bits to be added and the third input is a carry bit. The first output is the sum and the second output is carry bit for the next adder. The circuit contains 2 XOR gates, 2 AND gate and 1 OR gate. So this is the quiet explanation of the circuit. Next point is decide on a vocabulary. We know that we want to talk about circuit, terminals, signals and gates. The next step is to choose functions, predicates, constants to represent them. First, we need to be able to distinguish gates from each other and from the objects. Each gate is represented as an object named by a constant about which we assert that it is a gate with, say, gate X1. The behavior of each gate is determined by its type, one of the constants AND or XOR or NOT. Because a gate has exactly one type, a function is appropriate, that is type of X1 is equal to XOR. So this is quite a representation. Circuits like gates are identified by predicate circuit C1. Now next, we consider terminals which are identified by the predicate terminals X1. A gate or a circuit can have one or more input terminals and one or more output terminals. We use the function in 1, X1 to denote the first input terminal for gate X1. A similar function out is used for output terminal. The function Arctic CINJ says that circuit C has I input, J output terminals. The connectivity between the gates can be represented by a predicate connected, which takes two terminal as argument, as in connected out 1, x1 in 1, x2. So it's out and this word in. Finally, we need to know whether a signal is on or off. One possibility is to use a unary predicate on T, which is true when the signal at a terminal is on. This makes it a little difficult. However, to pose a question such as what are the possible values of the signal at the output terminal of the circuit C1, we therefore introduce an object, two signals, signal values 1 and 0, and a function signal T that denotes a signal value for the terminal T. Now encode the general knowledge of the domain. Now whatever the knowledge we have about the domain of the circuit, we have to encode or we have to implement it one by one. The one sign that we have a good ontology is that we require only a few general rules which can be stated clearly and concisely. These are all axioms we need. If two terminals are connected, then they have the same signal. So this is the one thought we have presented. So I can represent like this. So signal T1 is equal to signal T2. It means if two terminals are connected, T1 and T2 are the terminals, then they have the same signal. The signal at every terminal is either a 1 or a 0. So I can write like this. So this implies signal 1 or a 0. Connected is cumulative. So cumulative means I can represent in mathematical formula like this. There are four types of gates. So AND gate, OR gate, XOR gate and NOT gate. So these are the four types of the gates. And AND gate's output is 0 if and only if any of its input is 0. So this is the fifth sentence we have analyzed. And we can represent like this. And OR gate output is 1 if and only if any of its input is 1. So that can be represented like this. An XOR gate is output is 1 if and only if its input is its inputs are different. So this is the mathematical representation of the gates. Next, a NOT gate's output is different from its input. How we are going to represent it? By using this equation. An AND gate's output is 0 if and only if any of its input is 0. So we can represent like this. And OR gate's output is 1 if and only if any of its input is 1. An XOR gate output is 1 if and only if its input are different. So this is the representation of what the logic we are going to apply. And NOT gate's output is different from its input. The gate, that is except for NOT gate, have two inputs and one output. So I can represent like this. A circuit has a terminal up to its input and output arity and nothing beyond its arity. So this is the representation. Gates, terminal signals, gate types and nothing are all distinct. Gates are circuits. So I can represent like this. Now how we are going to encode the specific problem domain? The circuit shown in the last figure, that is 8.6, is encoded as circuit C1 with the following description. First, we categorize the circuit and its component gates. So I can categorize like this. So all these questions are based on the above presumptions. Next point is prepositional versus first order inference. So what the difference between prepositional logic and what is the difference between first order logic or first order inference? Now inference rules for quantifiers. Now let us begin with universal quantifier. Suppose our knowledge base contains the standard folkloric and axioms stating that all greedy kings are evil. So by using this universal quantifier, I can represent like this. Then it seems quite permissible to infer any of the following sentence. Now this is the representation. The rule of universal instantiation UI says that we can infer any sentence obtained by substituting a ground term for a variable. Now to write out the inference rule formally, we use a notation substitution. So representation is SUBST theta comma alpha. Denote that the result applying the substitution theta to the sentence alpha. Then the rule can be written as like this. For any variable v and ground term t. So this will be the universal qualifier. For example, the three sentences given earlier are obtained with the substitution x oblique John, x oblique Richard and x oblique Father John. In the rule for exponential instantiation, the rule is replaced by a single new constant symbol. The formal statement is as follows. For any instance a, variable v and a constant symbol k that does not appear elsewhere in the knowledge base. For example, from the sentence like this, we can infer that the crown C1 disjunction on head C1 comma John as long as C1 does not appear elsewhere in the knowledge base. Basically, the exponential sentence says that there is some object satisfying a condition, and applying the exponential instantiation rule just gives a name to that object. Now the next point is how we are going to make the reduction to the proportional inference. Now the first idea is that just as an quantified sentence can be replaced by one instantiation, a universally quantified sentence can be replaced by the set of all possible instantiation. For example, suppose our knowledge base contains just a sentence like this: King John, Grady John, Brother Richard John. Then we apply UI to the first sentence using all possible ground term substitution from the vocabulary of the knowledge base. In this case, X John and X or X oblique Richard, we obtained the equation like this. So King John disjunction Grady John implies evil John. So like this we can obtain the conclusion for this sentence also. And we discard the universally quantified sentence. Now the knowledge base is essentially propositional. If we view the ground atomic sentence King John, Grady John and so on as a propositional symbols, therefore we can apply any of the complete propositional algorithm to obtain conclusions such as evil John. This technique of proportionalization can be made completely general. That is, every first order knowledge base and a query can be proportionalized in such a way that entailment is preserved. Thus, we have a complete decision procedure for entailment, or perhaps not. There is a problem when the knowledge base includes a function symbol, the set of possible ground term substitution is infinite. For example, if the knowledge base mentions the father symbol, then infinitely many nested terms such as father, father of father, it means that the father of John and that father's father, that is grandfather and great grandfather, can be constructed. Our proportional algorithm we will have difficulty with an infinitely large set of sentences. Now the next point is unification and lifting. The preceding section described the understanding of the first order inference that existed up to the early 1960s. The sharp-eyed reader will have noticed that the proportionalization approach is rather inefficient. For example, given a query evil x, evil of x and the knowledge base in equation 9.1. It seems preserved to generate sentences such as King Richard, disjunction Grady Richard implies evil Richard. Indeed, the inference of a evil John from the sentence. Now, this is universal qualifier x, king of x, disjunction Grady x implies evil x. So, we can represent sentence like this. Now, this seems completely obvious to a human being. We now show how to make it completely obvious to a computer. Now, next point is a first order inference rule. We can actually make the inference step do even more work. Suppose that instead of knowing Grady John's, we know that everyone is Grady. So we can write like this. This is universal qualifier Y, Grady Y. That means everyone is Grady. Then we would still like to be able to conclude that evil John, because we know that John is a king, that is given already. John is a Grady because everyone is Grady. What we need for this to work is to find a substitution both for the variables in the implication sentence and for the variables in the sentences that are in the knowledge base. In this case, applying the substitution x oblique John, y oblique John means x or John, y or John to be implication premises King X and Grady X, and the knowledge base sentence King of John and Grady of Y will make them identical. Thus, we can infer the conclusion of the implication. This inference process can be captured as a single inference rule that we call generalized modulus fairness. Second, for atomic sentence PI, PI and Q, where there is a substitution theta, such that substitution theta PI is equal to substitution theta PI for all I, P1, P2 up to Pn. Now, there are n plus 1 premises in this rule. The n atomic sentences PI and the one implication. This conclusion is the result of applying the substitution theta to the subsequent Q. For example, P1 is a king, John P1 is a king, X2, P2. So, like this, we can apply the logic and apply the mathematical formulas. It is easy to show that the generalized modulus fairness is a sound inference rule. First, we observe that for any sentence P and for any substitution theta, PR is equal to substitution theta P. Now, this holds by universal instantiation. It holds a particular for a theta that satisfies the condition of a generalized modulus fairness rule. So, this is the modulus fairness rule where we are going to apply this substitution. Now, we talk about the unification. Lifted inference rule require finding substitution that make a different logical expression look identical. Now, this process is called as unification and the key component of all first order inference algorithm. The unifier algorithm takes two sentences and return a unifier for them if one exists. A unifier P oblique P and Q implies, tends to theta, where substitution theta and P is equal to substitution theta and Q. Now, let us look at some examples of how unify should behave. Suppose we have a query ask variable knows John and X. So, whom does John know? This will be the equation. Answer to this query can be found by finding all sentences in the knowledge base that unify with knows John, X. Here are the result of unification with four different sentences that might be in the knowledge base. So unify is a keyword and knows what we want to know, John and X. So whether X knows John. The last unification fails because X cannot take on the values John and Elizabeth at the same time. Yeah, because in the last sentence unify knows John, X knows X, Elizabeth is equal to fail. Now remember that knows X, Elizabeth means everyone knows Elizabeth. So, we should be able to infer that John knows Elizabeth, the problem arises only because the two sentences happen to use the same variable name X. The problem can be avoided by standardizing apart one of the two sentences being unified, which means renaming its variable to avoid name clashes. So that is called as standardizing apart. It means you have to apply the naming conventions. For example, we can rename X in knows X, Elizabeth to X17, a new variable, without changing its meaning. So the equation or the unique fiction will be unify knows John X knows X17 Elizabeth is equal to X/Elizabeth X17/John. Now, the next point is storage and retrieval. How we are going to store the values or the information and how we are going to retrieve it. Already we have seen tell and ask functions. So in the tell function we are going to give the response, and in the ask function we are going to ask the question. Underlying the tell and ask function used to inform and interrogate a knowledge base are the more primitive store and fetch function. Store as stores a sentence as into a knowledge base, and fetch, that is Q, returns all unifiers such that the query Q unifies with some sentence in the knowledge base. The problem we use to illustrate unification, finding all facts that unify with knows John, X, is an instance of fetching. The simplest way to implement store and fetch is to keep all the facts in one long list and unify each query against every element of the list. Such a process is inefficient, but it works, and it's all you need to understand the rest of the chapter. The remainder of this section outlines ways to make retrieval more efficient. It can be skipped for the first reading. We can make a fetch more efficient by ensuring that unification are attempted only with sentences that have some chance of unifying. For example, there is no point in trying to unify knows John X with brother Richard John. We can avoid such unification by indexing the fact in the knowledge base. A simple scheme called predictive indexing puts all the knows fact in one bucket and all the brother fact in another. The buckets can be stored in a hash table for efficient access. Now, this is the function unify, where x, y, and theta, these are the inputs, and it is going to return a substitution to make x and y identical. So the inputs are x is a variable, maybe a variable or a constant or a list or a compound expression, y a variable or a constant, list or a compound expression, and theta is a substitution built up so far. So this will be the logic we are going to apply for the function unify. The figure is unification algorithm. The algorithm works by comparing the structure of the input element by element. Substitution theta, that is an argument to unify, is built up along the way and is used to make sure that later comparisons are consistent with bindings that are established earlier. In compound expressions such as f of a b on the OPF field picks out the function symbol f, and arguments field picks out the argument list ab. Now the subsumption lattice, whose lowest node is employs IBM and Richard. The subsumption lattice for the sentence employs John and John. So this will be the diagrammatic representation. Now here is the explanation of whatever we have seen the diagram. Given a sentence to be stored, it is possible to construct indices for all possible queries that unify with it. For the fact employee IBM and Richard, the queries are: employs IBM Richard, does IBM employ Richard, employ X Richard, who employ Richard, employ IBM Y, whom does IBM employ. So these are a variety of questions we can construct for all possible queries. So here we have to construct the indices for all possible queries. Now this core is from a subsumption lattice, that is what we have seen in the previous diagram. The lattice has some interesting properties. For example, the child of any node in the lattice is obtained from its parent by a single substitution, and the highest common descendants of any two nodes is the result of applying their most general unifier. The portion of the lattice above any ground fact can be constructed systematically. A sentence with repeated constants has a slightly different lattice as shown in the figure 9.2, that is previous figure. Function symbols and variables in the sentence to be stored in introduce still more interesting lattice structure. Next, we are going to talk about the forward chaining. Now the idea is very simple. Start with the atomic sentence. Now already we have seen what is the single atomic sentence and what is the complex sentence. Now start with the atomic sentence in the knowledge base and apply modus ponens in the forward direction. Now adding a new atomic sentence until no further inference can be made. Here we explain how the algorithm is applied to the first order definite clauses. Definite clauses such as situation implies a response are especially useful for systems that make inference in response to a newly arrived information. Many systems can be identified this way, and forward chaining can be implemented very efficiently. Now the next point is first order definite clauses. The first order definite clauses closely resemble propositional definite clauses. They are disjunctions of literals of which exactly one is positive. A definite clause either is atomic or is an implication whose antecedent is a conjunction of a positive literals and whose consequent is a single positive literal. The following are the first order definite clauses. King X, disjunction greedy X implies evil X. King John and greedy Y. Unlike a proportional literals, first order literal can be include variables in which case those variables are assumed to be universally quantified. Not every knowledge base can be converted into a set of definite clauses because of the single positive literal restriction, but many can. Consider the following problem. The law says that it is a crime for an American to sell weapons to hostile nations. Now the country NATO, an enemy of America, has some missiles, and all of its missiles were sold to it by Colonel West, who is American. So this is the name of a person, Colonel West, who is in the America, and he has sold the weapons. We will prove that West is a criminal. First, we will represent these facts as a first order definite clause. The next section shows how the forward chaining algorithm solves the problem. It is a crime for an American to sell weapons to hostile nations. Now American X disjunction weapon Y disjunction sells XYZ disjunction hostile Z implies a criminal X. NATO has some missiles. The sentence like this is transformed into two definite clauses by exponential instantiation, introduces a new constant, that is M1. So we can represent like this. All of its missiles were sold by the Colonel West. Missile X disjunction owns NATO, X implies sells West, X NATO. So whatever the explanation over here, that is forward chaining, that means one thing is going from one man to another and from second to third. So one thing is going from first man to second, from second to third. So like this, the representation of the weapon is over here. The same is represented over here. Now this knowledge base contains no function symbols and is therefore an instance of a class data log knowledge bases. Data log is a language that is restricted to the first order definite clauses with no function symbols. Datalog gets its name because it can represent the type of statements typically made in relational databases. We will see that absence of function symbols make inference much easier. So this was the end of this lecture. The remaining points we will see in the next chapter. Thank you.